I've had conversations with producers about scripts and this and so forth and so on. And they always say, you know, in the Wild Bunch, I would have never let you get away with that line where they just said, let's go. I mean, that was the place in the film for a speech, you know? That's where the guys should have said what their whole thing was about. And I've always said, hey, if the movie doesn't say it, there's no line in the world you can write at that point that's going to help. And it's funny because it did just say, let's go, and it was really Sam's direction that made the line work. It was that long walk and the prep for that final sequence that made it come together. Waylon Green.
Peckinpah's genius for improvisation made whole sequences appear to materialize out of thin air. It was that way with the Bunch's final march to their deaths, which was a scant three-line description in the screenplay. After they'd filmed the Bunch moving to their horses to get their guns, the assistant director, Cliff Coleman, began issuing orders for the next setup, which was supposed to be the Bunch's arrival at Mapache's courtyard. But Sam stopped him.
No, no, Cliff, wait. I want to do a walk thing first.
These are the moments Coleman had learned to dread.
What do you mean, a walk thing?
Peckinpah growled something unintelligible, then began lining up Holden, Borgnine, Oates, and Johnson to make a long, long walk past the outlying buildings with their shotguns cradled in their arms. Suddenly, Peckinpah's pace quickened. He set up a group of drunken Mexican soldiers playing guitars and singing for the Bunch to walk past. Coleman and his colleague, Jesus Marin, began layering in other extras in the foreground, background, and at the edges of the frame, and giving them things to do, while Peckinpah moved the camera back, 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 and slapped a long lens onto it.
And all of a sudden, Jesus Christ, the music's going, the camera's rolling, and these fucking guys start to walk, and everybody's going, wow, it's a real thing. Nobody knew what Sam was gonna do, or what he wanted to do. Before you knew it, built and built and it built and it built until it became that scene.
They were just outlaws with no goals except let's get some money, fellas, and take it from there. Time has passed them by, and through their experience in a little Mexican village with one of their group played by Jaime Sanchez. When they go to visit his village, they learn if you have to rob and steal and, God help us, even kill, do it for a cause, for a reason.
Edmund O'Brien.
What do you want?
We want Angel.
The whole idea was, who would really do that? Rob and kill, steal guns, and yet in the end give the guns away to the peasants and go back for Angel and die for him. Because every guy that wrote a Western wrote that story. But it never works. It's pure romance. Sam said,
what if we made a film where they really did that? Well, what kind of guys would really do that? Walk in and sacrifice themselves like that?
So that was the intent from the outset, to make that story work. Who is Thornton? What was Crazy Lee to any of them? What the hell was the second act? Sam realized it was the backstory, which had to be built in because you have a story of men wanting to change, but in the end, refusing to. Jim Silk.
The point of the film is to take this facade of movie violence and open it up. Get people involved in it so that they are starting to go in the Hollywood television predictable reaction syndrome and then twist it so it's not fun anymore. Just a wave of sickness in the gut. Then there is a strange existentialist little number when the bunch turn around and everybody has got their hands up and they can get out. And they know it. And they look at each other and they start to laugh because they know this is the end. And they want it all.
It took 12 days, and we called it the Battle of Bloody Porch. I only had 350 Mexican soldier uniforms, and we blew up 6,000 of them. I had a uniform repair factory going right behind the blood hits. They'd come through there after getting shot and hit with hot water and washed off. We put tape behind the bullet holes, and I had a painter that would be painting them khaki. They'd come in bloody, ragged, torn, and they'd be taped up, painted over the tape, stuck in front of a heater lamp to dry the paint off, and a guy would go over with the patch with dirty gloves, make it look like aged cloth, and we'd throw them back out in front of the cameras to get blown up again. It was quite an operation. Gordon Dawson.